Welcome to Nokomis Heights Lutheran Church in Minneapolis, Minnesota. My name is Pastor Chris Capel, and I'm so glad that you joined us this morning for worship. Wherever you are, wherever you've been, wherever you come from, hope that you know through this worship service that you will hear and come to know God's love for you. Today we celebrate the Festival of All Saints, which is a day when we remember that all those who have gone before are people who, saint and sinner alike, have been baptized into God's love. And so we celebrate those people who have gone before today in worship. And we also remember that all of us, as Martin Luther said, are called both saint and sinner. We are saints by God's love alone in our baptism. And so we rejoice in that today. I have here the book that in this are written all the names of people who are remembered at Nokomis Heights since the year, I don't even know what year this started, 2003 it looks like, 2002, 2001. Anyway, for a long time, Nokomis Heights has been writing the names of those who have gone before in this book. And this year, we invited people to email in names of people who have gone before, so they have been written in this book as well. And today we will remember those people as we worship together. There is a story about a little boy who was sitting in worship with his mom one Sunday and looking at all the stained glass windows. And he asked his mom about all the different people who were depicted in the stained glass windows. And so she told him about St. Matthew and St. John and all the different saints of the church. A couple days later, the same little boy was sitting in a class in school, and his teacher mentioned something about a saint. And he raised his hand and he said, "I know what a saint is. A saint is somebody that God's light shines through." Pretty cool that he put two and two together and understood what that meant, right? Well, today that's what we celebrate. We celebrate that God's light shines through each one of us. And as we worship today, we worship knowing that we are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses, those people whom we have known and loved and who go before, connected with us through our baptism and through God's love for each of us. In the spirit of the Festival of All Saints, we have invited some grandparents who are part of Nokomis Heights Lutheran Church to share their hopes, their dreams, their wishes, their blessings for their grandchildren. So throughout this worship service this morning, enjoy the blessings of these grandparents from Nokomis Heights.
My hope for my grandchildren's generation, or my advice, is to be fully present in each moment. Our daughter Sarah's first grade teacher, Mrs. Greener, gave this demonstration to her class. In one hand, she held a rock, and in the other, a sponge. Dipping each in water, she showed how the water ran off of the rock while it was held by the dripping, saturated sponge. The lesson was simple. Be a sponge, ready to receive what each day brings, the people, the knowledge, the wisdom, the experiences. Other advice is to be generous, ready to give of what you receive. Be active and engaged where you are planted, ready to listen, learn, and to bless those around you with your gifts. In everything you do, be patient. The moments between the landmarks are rarely glamorous. In your faith walk, your careers, your relationships, and in your life, the results you desire won't come immediately, but will require patient cultivation in those little in-between moments. And finally, always be mindful of our Creator and give thanks daily.
I'm kind of close to that. My advice for our grandchildren is three things. First of all, be thankful. Be thankful every day for the Creator. Be thankful every day for the life that you've been given. Be thankful every day for all of the ways that the Creator makes your life better. And be thankful for the grace available to us in Jesus. Second thing, be generous. Make sure you realize that everything you have comes to you from God, that God has blessed you in many ways that you can never even understand. So when it comes time to be generous with others, with those around you, give freely. And the third thing would be to make a difference in somebody else's life, to make sure that your aim in life is to make other people's lives better in the name of the God who's made you.
We enter into worship giving thanks to God for our baptisms. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery and into freedom. At the river Jordan, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
We remember with joy the newest saints, those baptized during this past year. Remington Batker, Finley Skugrud, Willow Bottom, and Ethan Knox. And we remember with thanksgiving those members of Nokomis Heights who have lived and died in the faith. They are the sign of our hope and an image of the glory we shall inherit. Even more, they are worshipers with us on this day as we sing the praises of God who brings life out of death. We remember Norma Danielson and Cyrus Kingsburg. We also remember those who are listed in the memorial book, those dear to us who have died.
Cyrus Jean Carrillo Capel,
Alice
Barbara
Thompson,
Thompson Capel,
Dale Clarence Jensen,
Dr. Richard Jensen,
Sig Margaret Helm, Nelson,
Vic Levine,
Helen Nelson,
Stephen Levine,
Richard
Margaret Nelson,
Ryan
Nelson, Carl Scheid,
Ryan Holt,
Martha Scheid,
Sarah Nelson,
Joyce Cairns,
Bob Norris,
Ralph
Nelson,
Gibb
Lazarus,
Jamie Kimmerer,
Jenny Robinson,
Ray Seville,
Cable. William
Harold
Kimmerer Jr.,
Gladys Christopher,
Ann Rover,
Sarah Jean Kimmerer,
Jean
Carrillo,
Barbara Thompson,
Clarence Thompson,
Cyrus Kingsburg,
Margaret Nelson,
Raymond
Madison,
Thank you.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servants, who now rest in you. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, sheep of your own fold, lambs of your own flock, sinners of your own redeeming. Keep them in the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Rest eternal grant them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them.
The first reading is from 1 Kings, chapter 17. But after a while, the wadi dried up, because there was no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, saying, Go now to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and live there, for I have commanded a widow there to feed you. So he set out and went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and said, Bring me a little water in a vessel, so that I may drink. As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. But she said, As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now preparing a couple of sticks, so that I may go home and prepare for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. Elijah said to her, Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said, but first make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards make something for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, The jar of meal will not be emptied, and the jug of oil will not fail until the day that the Lord sends rain on the earth. She went and did as Elijah said, so that she, as well as he and her household, ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke by Elijah. After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill. His illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. She then said to Elijah, What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son. But he said to her, Give me your son. He took him from her bosom, carried him up into the upper chamber where he was lodging, and laid him on his own bed. He cried out to the Lord, O Lord my God, have you brought calamity even upon the widow with whom I am staying by killing her son? Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried out to the Lord, O Lord my God, let this child's life come into him again. The Lord listened to the voice of Elijah. The life of the child came into him again, and he revived. Elijah took the child, brought him down from the upper chamber into the house, and gave him to his mother. Then Elijah said, See, your son is alive. So the woman said to Elijah, Now that I know you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord is in your mouth is truth. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from Hebrews chapter 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, Let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that it clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
As children of God, we all have responsibilities to take care of Mother Earth, the sky, and any vulnerable, disadvantaged fellow human beings. Always remember your baptismal promises, that you are a child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit, and marked with the cross of Christ forever.
I think to add to that would be, I hope there are similar opportunities for our grandchildren like that we had, whether they're financial, spiritual, career, things of that nature. And I think the biggest thing is I would hope that my granddaughter and any future grandchildren can grow up to be respectful citizens of planet Earth, and carry that into their future and teach their children as well.
When I was a kid, every Memorial Day weekend, we, as my family, would pick flowers from our yard. Usually they were irises, and we'd wrap them up in wet paper towels and tin foil, and we'd pack a picnic, and then we would make our way to all the family cemeteries. Now, my grandparents had all passed away by the time I was born, and so I didn't know them. So when we would go to the cemeteries, it was really an opportunity for my sister and I to learn about our grandparents, who we never had the privilege of knowing. And we would stand around graves just like this, and we would look at the names, and we would ask my parents to tell us stories. Story after story they would tell of grandparents and aunts and uncles who had gone before, of cousins who had died in the faith. There was my dad's really crabby dad, who he would struggle to call a saint. And there was my mom's mom, who died when my mom was only 10 years old, whom she barely remembered, but she certainly knew a lot of stories about her. I remember just being in awe of the mystery, of the fact that even though I never knew these people, my story was inextricably woven together with their story. I was because they were. And the way in which they lived their lives really informed the way in which I would live my life. It's pretty amazing the way that God knits us all together. And today on All Saints Day, that's what we celebrate. We celebrate that we are all woven together in one big family of God. And every time we come together to worship, we worship surrounded by all the saints, living or dead. We worship together in this great mystery that is God's love. And we remember that all of our stories are woven together in God's big story. Today we enter into God's story in the book of 1 Kings, which probably isn't a book that you open your Bible to very often. We're introduced here to Elijah the prophet. Now, Elijah was a prophet in the time of King Ahab. King Ahab was married to Jezebel, and Jezebel was a worshiper of Baal. Baal was not a god that the God of Israel wanted people worshiping. In fact, it was one of the main things that God said, you shall have only one God, and God abhorred the god of Baal. So Elijah's main job was to turn people back toward the one true God and turn people away from Baal. Now, when we first meet Elijah, he is going through a time of famine in the northern kingdom of Israel, and God has placed him next to this wadi, which is basically a pond, and God has said, even though there's a famine and a drought going on here, you drink from the wadi and I will send you food from the ravens 3 or 4 times a day. So the ravens brought him meat and he drank from the wadi until the wadi dried up, which is where our lesson begins today. The wadi dries up, he has no more to drink. And so God sends Elijah to this widow We know her as the widow of Zarephath, like so many other women in Scripture. She doesn't have a name, but she has a really beautiful role to play. Elijah goes to the widow of Zarephath, like God tells her, and says, God says that you'll take care of me if I come here. Can you please make me some food? Now, if we think about who that widow might have been today, it was a time of famine. It was a time of really societal poverty. So let's just imagine that this widow was living maybe in the tent city over by Lake Nokomis. She was living there with her son, and she really didn't have very many resources, but she had just a little bit of food from the food pantry. And this rugged man, Elijah, comes to her tent door one day and says, hey, God says you'll feed me. What would your response be? I'm pretty sure I might send that person away wondering if he really had my best intentions in mind. But this widow, something opened up in her heart. And she said, well, I don't have very much, but I guess I'll feed you. So she goes and she actually says to him, I'm going to take my very last bit of flour and my very last bit of water and oil, and I'll mix it together and I'll make bread for us, and then my son and I will die. I mean, it's pretty dramatic. She really says, this is the last food that we have. Well, Elijah promises her that if she feeds him and takes care of him, that God will take care of her. So she mixes together her very last bit of flour and oil and some water, and she makes some bread, and the widow and her son and Elijah, well, they all eat. And the next day, God provides again for them, some flour and some water and some oil, and they eat again. And every day until the famine has ended, the widow and her son and Elijah have enough food for that day. They learn to trust in God, and they learn to rely on one another. Now, following this particular episode of Elijah and the widow, the widow's son actually dies tragically. And she throws up her hands to Elijah and says, this God that sent you to me would let me take care of you and then let my son die? And so Elijah actually prays to God and lays on her son in this really strange story in the Bible. And the son is brought back to life, is resurrected. And so we see this really amazing story of two people, Elijah and the widow, whose lives never would have come together except that somehow God brought them together. And now for all of eternity, their stories are inextricably woven to one another's. When we think about what it means to live as people of faith in this world, when we think about what it means to have our stories knit together with all of these people who have gone before, including Elijah and the widow, when we think about who it is that God has created us to be in this world, I think that there are two things that are really important for us to remember on this All Saints today, All Saints Day. And these two things are really simple. If we think about our lives in the form of a cross, that we are connected to God, each and every one of us. And that's kind of the upward movement of the cross. And we are connected with one another, each and every one of us. And that's the side-to-side movement of the cross. We're connected to God, and we're connected to one another. And God sends people into our life and weaves our stories together so that we might be a blessing in one another's lives, so that we might shine the light of Jesus for one another in this world. So today, as you remember those people who have been saints in your life, saints and sinners alike, know that those are people that God blessed you with in this life. And as you live your life, think about the people that God puts in your path and how it is that God wants you to shine your light into their lives. Now, I know that we're living in this time of just complete disconnection in this world. One member of Nokomis Heights who is living in a senior center building has jokingly said that she's incarcerated, which I know she jokes about, but I also know that it can feel really lonely during this pandemic For anyone who's living alone or even with one other person, or even for me, with the three people living in my household, even though I have people, sometimes it just feels like the world is so disconnected. So I just want to encourage you to pick up the phone this week, to maybe email somebody, to spend some time in scripture reading stories of those who have gone before, and to know that you are never alone. Through Jesus, you are always connected with God. Jesus came so that you would know that you're never alone. And God wants you to be connected with other people in this world. And that's such a gift. And it's one of the most unique gifts that the church has to offer, is this connection that we have with one another, because we are all living in the promise of our baptism together. Now, at the end of this week, you will receive in your email box an opportunity to sign up for life groups through Nokomis Heights. This is one way that we just really feel called to be faithful as a church, to connect ourselves to one another during this time of pandemic when we feel so isolated and lost and alone. So if you get that email and you feel a nudge from God to be connected to other people of faith, to be able to share life together, I want to encourage you that I really think these groups will be a blessing for us as a community of faith. It'll be a way for us to live into our calling of being connected with one another and being connected with God. May God bless each of you on this All Saints Day as you remember those faithful saints who have gone before, as you give thanks to God for the people to whom you are connected in your world and in your life, and as you remember all those saints in Scripture, those stories that God blesses us with, like the widow and Elijah, who remind us what it means to care for one another in this life. Amen.
Welcome to my home. I'm Sylvia Storvik, a longtime member of Nokomis Heights. And I was asked to give some comments on my advice to my grandchildren for the future. My grandchildren were here for my 90th birthday party last week. So I discussed the matter with them. And these were our comments. We discussed, number one, fear. If you are fearful, it will limit your life. Maybe fearful of getting a new job, or fearful of not passing a test. And it's something to deal with in your life. Number two was choices. Be careful to make good choices, especially with friends. Some friends lift you up and some friends tear you down. And then there are choices in jobs, choices maybe where you're going to move. I mean, we all make choices throughout our whole life. Some are good, some are bad. But we can learn from choices. And the third one was to set goals. If you don't set goals, you will flounder. Or my father used to say, if you don't set goals, you'll perish. That's a little strong. But it's kind of true, I think. You have something to work for, and then if you make it, you feel really good inside. And if you don't make it, you pick yourself up and try something else. Lots of young people changing jobs these days. It was kind of unthinkable years ago. But I don't think it's such a bad thing. I think, you know, we want to be happy. Life is short. And to try new things. And this one is mine. To show compassion and love and forgiveness. Easy words to say. Sometimes difficult to do. But I think we can learn from our teachings in the church and the example of Jesus on the cross. There was forgiveness. God bless you all. Thank you.
With confidence in God's mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. We give you thanks for all the people who have guided us, helped us, and provided key support on our journey. Make us signposts and blessings to others as well, for we are all joined in one body. Gracious God, hear our prayer. The artifice of changing clocks and shifting times reminds us how relative and impermanent are the systems and structures we have set up to mark and measure our days. Give us a vision of our eternal kingdom, that we might always keep the most important things in our sight. Gracious God, hear our prayer. As Elijah revived the widow's son by your Spirit's power, so revive us when we are dead to hope and reigned to despair. Send your Spirit of healing to all those whom we know are in need of it. We pray especially today for those we name in the silence of our hearts at this time. Gracious God, hear our prayer. Hold all of those for whom we pray in your loving embrace, and hear our prayers for the sake of the one who prayed for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our daughter Lauren and son-in-law Isaac are excitedly looking forward to the birth of their first child next month. And that makes us the very happy first-time grandparents of little girl Pritchard.
It is a rather unsettled time to welcome a child into this world of instability and uncertainty. I've heard some people say that because of all this, for instance, the pandemic and social unrest, they wouldn't want to consider having a baby right now.
But our granddaughter and other infants being welcomed into their new families are our hope for a brighter future.
Our hope is that as they grow, children and young adults will hear the call to serve, be spurred into action, and strive to create communities that work towards social justice, kindness and acceptance, caring for one's neighbor, and environmental responsibility. Of course, this must all begin with our own generation, setting the examples from which youth can learn and be inspired.
These are lofty hopes and wishes for Lauren and Isaac's little one yet to be born. So, along the way, we hope that she can simply enjoy the wonders and experiences of childhood in the carefree way childhood is idyllically intended.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you to go ahead and share God's peace with one another if you're worshiping with somebody today in your home, or send somebody a text message or pick up the phone and call someone and remind them that they are loved today. At this time, we gather the gifts of the church, which means that we invite you to share out of your abundance with all those in need. Just as the widow cared for Elijah, God asks us to care for one another. And when we share offerings with God's church, that's what we're doing. We're caring for one another as God has called us to do. Let us pray. When we share what we have, our blessings and our joy are multiplied. Receive these gifts which we offer your kingdom work on earth, that justice would prevail and all your children would know your love and care, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, I would love to give you two options for communion. One thing is you could pause the video and go to your refrigerator and get some grape juice or wine or apple juice and get a little piece of bread out of your kitchen or a cracker and take communion with your family or by yourself this morning. Or later on in the afternoon, there's an opportunity to come to church and receive communion. I will be there all afternoon, and there's a sign up that has been sent to your email several times. There's still room to sign up. One of my favorite images is when I come to communion, imagining that all of those who have died in the faith are communing with me, because that is actually what God promises, that we are all together. Faith, hope, and love remain, 1 Corinthians says, and the greatest of these is love. And so even though people are gone, their love remains, and so they're with us as we commune together. So on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he blessed it, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new promise in my blood. It's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
If I were to talk to my grandchildren directly, these are the things that I think it would be most important for me to convey to them. The first thing is always know that you are a worthy person just because you exist. You're loved and you don't have to be a certain way because somebody tells you to or because society says so. Not only is this true for you, of course, but it's also true for every other human being. And so that means not only do you have to stand up for yourself and pursue your own goals and passions and interests, but you also want to recognize that other people need to do the same thing for themselves. So take time to listen to others and be a human being with them. The luckiest people find meaning for themselves and also help to other people to find meaning that's what they're looking for. This attitude of reciprocal caring is even something that we can extend to the world as a whole. By that, I mean nature and the environment. I'm hoping that we all can keep working toward better stewardship of the resources that we have around us and that we use. If things don't go your way, make a point to make choices and take actions that are life-giving for you whenever possible. And don't forget to have gratitude for all the things in your life, just little things day by day, or the big things that go your way, or that the people that love you.
Let us pray. God of the welcome table, in this meal we have feasted on your goodness and have been united by your presence among us. Empower us to go forth sustained by these gifts so that we may share your neighborly love with all through Jesus Christ, the giver of abundant life. Amen.
My hope for the faith of my grandchildren is that they will live in the promise of their baptism that they are beloved children of God, and that they will live out the call of their baptism to proclaim Christ, to care for others and the world, and to work for justice and peace.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of our triune God, amen. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Bye.